Hey, hello, how are you? Welcome back! Meanwhile, in the celestial office of Archangel Gabriel, one of the seven overseers of heaven, Purple Heart stands ready to talk to Gabriel. Seraphim, do you know why I've called you here? Is this about Lilim? That's right. As you know, Lilim was banished from heaven 6 months ago for her gross misconduct. She consistently earned the lowest love tokens out of all the Cupids every month for the last 3 years in a row. She has no real devotion to her job as a Cupid, and no love for the humans she is supposed to serve. She does not make humans happy for the simple sake of doing a good deed, but because she has to, in order to replenish her own magical energy. If given the choice, she would prefer to read comics or play video games than do her work as a Cupid. This kind of behavior is absolutely unforgivable, especially for a graduate of Cupid Academy.
It is as you say. I don't know what voice I will be using. Lilim is lazy and opportunistic. She's always been that way, ever since we were classmates.
You two were friends at school, weren't you?
That is very true, yes. I hoped my influence would bend Lilim's ways, but I was overly optimistic. Despite my best attempts to tutor her, Lilim remained uninterested. She only studied for her exams at the last minute and must have passed by the skin of her teeth. Maybe I should have been harder with her. If I hadn't let her copy my homework or borrow my notes, she might have learned to study for herself. But she never did.
Do you regret it?
I regret it terribly. If I hadn't enabled her, then maybe Lilim could have changed her ways. Maybe she would have become a halfway decent Cupid. She would be still living in heaven. Maybe we could still be friends.
It seems you still care for her, even now.
My, your devotion to your friend really is admirable. You're not only a top-class Cupid Seraphim, but you have the patience and tolerance of an angel. Maybe you could even promote it to an angel if you play your cards right.
You would really offer me a promotion?
Yes, and a significant pay raise, too.
Miss Gabriel, that's very kind of you, but it's too much. I've only been a Cupid for a few years. I don't believe I have what it takes to be an angel or a CPU.
Angels are good, pure, and virtuous. They soothe the hearts of humans in subtle arguments. Sometimes they even intervene in politics to stop wars from breaking out between countries. It's a lot of responsibility. I'm not sure I can handle it.
Well, I'll leave the judge of that.
Oh, yes, miss. I didn't mean to offend.
It's fine. I'm not offended. I've been pondering whether I should promote you or not for a long time. You graduated from Cupid Academy at the highest grades in your year, and your performance has been impeccable. You always earn the most love tokens each month out of all of your colleagues. I'd like to promote you to the position of an angel as soon as possible to reward you for your hard work, but there is one thing I would like you to do first. One thing to prove your dedication to the offices of heaven.
And what is that, miss?
It's a small matter. It should be simple for you. I would like you to go to Earth, and I want you to return Lilim back to heaven, where she belongs.
But I thought Lilim was banished from heaven.
She was banished, but I never intended for her to stay down there permanently. Her banishment was supposed to be a temporary punishment for her slothful ways. I was convinced Lilim would hate it on Earth. I thought she would work hard to prove herself, so she could return to heaven. If she devoted herself to the ways of being a Cupid, I would have welcomed her back with open arms. But instead, her conduct was becoming worse. She has fallen much, much further than I ever imagined.
Oh no! Lilim! What has she done?
She has been using her powers as a Cupid on Earth for her own personal gain.
No!
It's true. She's been manipulating humans so they will give her their money. And that's just all. She has cast aside the traditional bow and arrow of a Cupid and has decided to reap love tokens in her own rather unique manner.
And how is she doing that, exactly?
Customized guns.
That's impossible!
Not for Lilim, apparently. Though she's intolerably lazy, her ideas are rather ingenious. Using her own customized guns and her love bullets, she has half-heartedly been performing her duties as a Cupid around Tokyo. But this is a problem.
Bullets contain much more magical energy than arrows. If she hits a person with a bullet, it could be dangerous.
Indeed. It's lucky she hasn't caused any accidents.
Well, she hadn't until yesterday. Did something go wrong?
She shot a human girl and made that girl fall in love with her.
No way! I can't believe it. She's directly violating all three of the most important rules of the Cupid rulebook. Cupids shouldn't reveal their identities to humans. Cupids shouldn't use their powers to make humans fall in love with them. And Cupids shouldn't use their powers against humans for their own gain.
Exactly. I was content to watch Lilum from afar and see how her rehabilitation progressed, but shooting that human girl is inexcusable. Lilum cannot be left to her own devices on Earth any longer. She must be brought back into our custody as soon as possible. This is the first time this has happened in almost 20 years, but if... What? Almost 20 years? What happened before? If Lilum is using her powers against the humans she is supposed to serve, then she is no better than a demon. She must bring her... You must bring her back to heaven so she can stop this mistress. Yes! Ah, you heard me before it's too late.
And what will you do with her when I brought her back?
We'll put her on trial, naturally.
Trial?
That's right. If she's found guilty, she might even be banished to hell.
Banished? That's awful. Lilum, she's always been a lazy, good-for-nothing girl, but she's not evil. She's not a demon.
Then you must return her to heaven. If you can stop her from making further errors, then we will be lenient in our punishment. There is still hope for her yet. She might not be banished.
But that all depends on you, Sarah.
On me?
Yes, bring her back quickly, for her own good.
You can do that, can't you?
After all, the two of you were friends. Best friends, I believe.
That's right. In Cupid Academy, Lilum was the only one who spoke to me. The other Cupids kept their distance. Maybe they were jealous of me, or maybe they thought I was too serious. But Lilum was never like that. She always smiled at me. She was the only one who did. She smiled at me so brightly, and she never let me be alone. She wasn't just my best friend. She was my only friend.
And you miss her, don't you?
Yes, I do. I miss her terribly.
Then you must help her while you can, just as she helped you. Lilum might not realize she needs helping, but that makes an intervention even more of a necessity. You have to save her, Seraphim. Save Lilum from herself. Save her before it's too late, and her actions can be no longer pardoned.
Right. I'll do it. I'll go to Earth and I'll bring Lilum back. I have to.
Good. See to it that you do. And if you return without runaway, you'll be rewarded most handsomely. Dot, dot. Oh, I knew she was a fucking evil person.
Lilum, it's rare that a Cupid steps out of line like this. I might be the head of discipline in heaven, but I haven't had a chance to exert my authority in decades. This should be fun. I hope you can bring Lilum back to me, Seraphim. I need to give her a proper, more than one punishment. I need to show her the error of her ways. I'll scold her for being such a bad girl. I'll take my time to scold her long and hard until she breaks. After all, isn't that what correction is all about?
Okay, who is this? Hey, Lilum! Lilum!
Huh?
Lilum, wake up!
What?
There's a voice. It's soft and feminine. It sounds vaguely familiar, but...
Please, give me just a few more minutes. My bed is so cozy right now, I just don't want to get up.
It's a lot warmer than usual, and the sheets smell nicer too. It's more homely? Strange. My bed isn't usually this comfortable, but now for some reason it feels like a small slice of heaven on earth. I never want to wake up.
Lilum gets me.
I'm allowed to, it's my house.
Drool is a fairy lady like that. I guess if it's from a beautiful woman like you, even that looks kind of cute. Yeah. I wonder if I could bottle up your drool and sell it as an anti-aging medicine. I'm sure it has curative properties. Maybe if I just tried a little...
I feel warm breath against my cheek. Wait a minute, what's going on here? Am I going to get ravaged in my slumber?
Thanks for the food.
I feel something brushing against my cheek. There are fingers in my hair. Warm breath tickles my skin. My room gets hotter and hotter. My head starts spinning.
Crap, this is getting dangerous. Show up in my eyes, quick! And what do you think you're doing? Quicker than lightning, I transform into a Cupid. My wings extend from my shoulder blades and my lingerie melts away to real, more tight-fitting lingerie, I guess? I don't know. Cupid uniforms are all pretty revealing. I think they're supposed to help wind resistance when we fly, but since Gabriel's the one who issues these, I think she might have designed them based on her own perverted fantasies. Whatever. I'm stronger in my Cupid form. My body is augmented by magic, so I can perform incredible feats I can't do as a human. I'll just explain this all to you while there's some sort of pervert in my room. It doesn't matter. Feet's like rising from my bed and grabbing a hold of my assailant. Oh, there we go. I seize them by the back of their neck. My dingy fingers dig into their unprotected skin so they whimper.
Yeah!
They decide to assault the gritted Cupid in the moon without any kind of armor? How foolish. Now they'll pay the price for their folly. Mercilessly, I press my captive down against my mattress, smashing their nose into the sheets.
Ah, Lulu. That's an interesting way to say good morning.
Oh. I look down at my captives. It's Mitsuki. The events from yesterday, impossible though they seem, come back to me in a sudden rush. The cafe, the love bullet, Mitsuki's confession. Mitsuki came back to my house like a lost puppy. I invited her in, and now... What were you doing exactly?
I wanted to wake you up, but you wouldn't budge no matter what I did.
I've never been good at getting up in the mornings. Me neither, Nalum. I used to get in trouble all the time back at Cubit Academy. If Sarah hadn't stopped by my house to wake me up almost every morning, I never would have gotten there on time.
And since you looked so pretty when you were asleep, I thought there was a little bit of drool at the corner of your mouth and I wanted to wipe it away for you.
Oh, I just noticed her. Your little ahoge is a heart.
I was just being helpful, you see? You wanted to wipe it away with your tongue.
Yes! I mean, that was such an idea, but you woke me up before I could.
Your reflexes really are amazing. You're good at everything, Lila.
I know. I preen, flipping my hair over one shoulder. I am rather talented.
You're incredibly talented.
Please praise me more.
You're gorgeous, and you have a good body and a great sense of humor. You're charming and confident, and... You're pretty good at giving chokeholds.
I can't breathe. Mitsuki's face is starting to turn a worrying shade of purple.
I can't breathe.
Oh, I'm sorry. Force of habit. I draw my fingers away from Mitsuki's pale, slender neck and take a step back.
Whoa! Where'd that come from?
Thank you.
Mitsuki presses one hand against her cheek and splutters. She inhales deeply, like a diver trying to fill their air with delicious oxygen. While she's choking, I phase out my Cupid form and put on my regular clothes. Then I turn back to Mitsuki. She slumped on the ground, head propped up against my bed. She doesn't look good. Did I overdo it? Using my Cupid magic against a human for my own gain is bad enough, but killing a human would make me look way worse.
Mitsuki, can you stand? I'm good.
You don't look good.
I'll be right. I'm strong. I come from a big family. I had to look after my little brothers all the time. Compared to them, this is nothing.
I think I'm rather more powerful than a group of Snotmore's boys.
You'd be surprised.
Mitsuki gets to her feet. Her legs are trembling and her clothes are rumpled, but she looks a little better now. At least her face isn't purple. Are we going to address the fact that she's wearing a maid outfit at some point? Her outfit, okay.
Hey, what exactly are you wearing? Oh, this?
Mitsuki looks down at herself in apparent surprise, like she's never seen herself before.
This is a little something I found when I was cleaning up your house. I thought it was cute, so I decided to put it on. What do you think?
Mitsuki does a little twirl. The hem of her maid's dress twirls with her. It's a cute maid's dress, I guess. The bottom is covered in ruffles, and the top part strains pretty tightly against Mitsuki's chest. It even comes complete with a cute frilly headband. Mitsuki said this was mine, did she? I don't remember buying it, but it seems like the sort of totally pointless thing I'd waste my money on. I wouldn't wear it myself. I don't have any fantasies about being subservient.
But I have a soft spot for cute girls dressed in maids waiting on me hand and foot.
You look very cute.
Do you really think so?
Totally. It's much better than the clothes you wear at the cafe.
I know, right? I've asked the owner over and over and over again to give us cute uniforms, but he just won't listen.
Mitsuki looks kind of dejected. She kicks at the ground with the tip of her foot. Her toes are encased in sheer white stockings that stop above her knee. How cute. I wonder if I can say anything to console her? Your manager doesn't know what he's missing out on. Your manager doesn't know a good thing when he sees it. If you dress like this, I bet your cafe would explode in popularity.
Totally! Well, maybe it's a good thing we don't have too many visitors. I'm not the best at customer service.
So, why did you decide to dress up as a maid?
Isn't it obvious? I want to serve you, Lulu.
But why?
Because you're the person I love, obviously. You were kind enough to give me a place to stay, and I'll never forget that. Not ever. I'm going to try and make myself as useful to you as possible, so I can let you live a life of luxury.
Having a cute girl in the maid outfit pledge her allegiance to me is pretty luxurious already. Though, I do wonder how much Mitsuki's actions have been influenced by the love bullet, yet again.
I guess it still hasn't worn off yet,
if she's up to such ridiculous antics so early in the morning.
That's why I've been hard at work.
What have you been doing, exactly? Other than trying to lick up my spittle.
That was just a one-off thing. It won't happen again.
Unless you wanted to. I'm the one who does the licking, Mitsu.
Whoa, okay.
Oh, I see. So, you want to be the dominant one?
Of course I'm the dominant one. You're dressed like a maid, but we're getting off the subject. What have you been working on while I was asleep?
I was tidying up your house. I scrubbed the bathtub, rinsed the faucets, wiped down the mirrors, and cleaned the toilet. I took out the trash and the garbage cans, and I swept all the floors and washed the plates in the sink. I put your dirty clothes in the washing machine, and I rearranged your bookshelves, and I untangled all the wires by your TV.
Wow, you really have been working hard.
I work as hard as I can.
When did you wake up, anyway?
6 in the morning.
Do you usually wake up that early?
Yeah, I always woke up early when I lived with my parents, so I could help them out around the house. I have 4 younger brothers. It's not easy to look after that many kids and keep a tidy household, you know?
I can imagine. Sounds like hell. Maybe that's what hell is actually like, full of screaming children.
I wouldn't know. I've never been.
Though Sarah's told me enough times that's where I'll be going if I don't straighten up.
And now I'm living in Tokyo. I need to get up early so I can make it to college.
You're such a hard worker. Mitsuki's so earnest. She kind of reminds me of Sarah, actually. But you don't need to wake up early now. You're on holiday, aren't you?
Yes, but my parents always tell me if you don't work, you don't eat. You're letting me stay here, Mom, so I have to earn my keep. You're the mistress and I'm your servant.
Hey, I hope she's not getting the wrong idea here. Just so you know, I'm not going to pay you.
That's fine, I don't want your money.
You don't?
No, just being with you is payment enough.
Okay, calm down there, girlfriend.
After all, I love you so much. I just want to make you happy.
Happy, happy slave girl. You're so sappy, Mitsu. I poke her on the nose with my index finger. Mitsuki goes momentarily cross-eyed.
But if you don't mind, I'd be more than happy to accept your help.
I should try to take advantage for this as long as it lasts. I mean, I've already broken one of the Cupid's sacred rules, so I might as well keep going, right?
What do I have left to lose?
I threw out my pride as a kid, but a long, long time ago.
So you're letting me stay?
If you really want. When the love bullet's effects wear off, she'll leave on her own. I just need to wait.
Yay, thank you. Then I'm going to double my efforts to please you, mistress.
Mistress, huh?
I could get used to that. I even made breakfast for you this morning, mistress.
I hope it's to your liking.
I don't know what you like exactly, so I just used up the leftover ingredients in the fridge. There wasn't that much food in there, so we'll probably need to buy more later.
I'm sorry if it was presumptuous of me.
Oh, don't worry, your pretty little head. It's fine. Really?
Of course. I give Mitsuki a reassuring smile and ruffle the top of her head. I'm sure any food made by your tender hands will taste delicious. If it's even half as good as your coffee, then I'm sold. I'm starting to drool again. Okay. Alright. Well, that looks appetizing. Looks great. I stand corrected. Abomination.
Well, what do you think?
Mitsuki smiles proudly. Her smile is very pure, just like freshly fallen snow. But that only increases the contrast between my expectations and reality. I mean, is Mitsuki seriously expecting me to eat this? Honestly? Mitsuki holds my breakfast on a plate before me. She looks so happy. Sparkles could be radiating from her face. But as for the food for itself, what is it meant to be exactly?
Silly Lulu, isn't it obvious?
It's really, really not.
It's a cheese and mushroom omelet.
What? With a fish head. Omelet, huh? Did I even have eggs in the fridge? When was the last time I went food shopping anyway? I usually order takeout and I rarely cook myself. The last time I went to the store was probably a month ago. Mitsuki, are you sure the ingredients you used are still fresh?
They were there, so I thought I might as well use them.
Besides, eggs don't go off. They have hard shells. I'm not so sure about that. That would explain the smell. Rancid egg omelet doesn't sound very appealing. I doubt you'd find it on the menu at a 5-star restaurant. Rotten eggs aside, I don't think there's any salvaging this omelet. It isn't yellow, it's a strange dark color. Or rather, it doesn't seem to be any color at all. It's just a lump of amorphous matter quivering nervously on my plate. Yes, that's right. The omelet is quivering. Shifting. Pulsating. Like it's alive. There are some things in this world that aren't meant to be, and this omelet is one of them. It's even more pitiful than Frankenstein's monster, and just as lethal.
Well, are you going to try it?
Do I really have to?
Of course, I made it with a lot of love.
Right. Now I'm starting to wonder. Maybe the love bullet's effects already wore off. Is this so-called omelet Mitsuki's attempt to punish me for shooting her last night? This could be some kind of clever plot. But Mitsuki's face shimmers with love and affection. I can't quite bring myself to blame her. She's being genuine.
Eat up, lemon. I'll go cold.
I don't know if that'll make much of a difference.
But if it's warm, you'll be able to feel the full extent of my love with every single bite. My love for you isn't lukewarm, it's piping hot.
That's what this omelet is supposed to represent. I even drew a heart on it, ketchup, see? I see. I look at the omelet dubiously. It looks back at me. I swear it sounds like it's screeching in pain.
Help me! Please, help me!
The poor thing. Maybe I should eat it and put it out of its misery, but then what would happen to me?
I've never made an omelet before. I was a little worried how it would turn out, but I think it's okay! I'm not the best at cooking, but I tried my hardest, so it would make me really happy if you ate this.
Crap! I feel my forehead breaking out in a cold sweat. What should I do? Oh, Save yourself! Yeah, there's just no way I'm eating this. It's triggering more death legs in the climax of Bladderless. I'm sorry, Mitsuki, but I'm not in the mood for an omelet right now.
But I made it just for you.
I know, and I appreciate it, but I'm allergic to eggs.
Oh, no, I didn't know. But then, if you're allergic, why did you have eggs in your fridge?
That's a good question. Mitsuki's a smart one. I guess this is what happens when I try to take on a doctor in training. A doctor in training who doesn't know eggs can go off, apparently. What does that even mean, eggs go off? Whatever. I was trying to build up a resistance to them, like Rasputin and the poison, you know?
Oh, yes, I've heard about that.
Exactly. Rasputin built up his tolerance to poison by consuming it daily in small quantities. He didn't die, even when people tried to kill him. I aim to be a person like that.
You don't want... You want to take over Imperial Russia?
At some point in the future, yes.
Wow, you really do have amazing dreams.
I know, right? I'm not content to settle for mediocrity. If you're going to have dreams, they might as well be big ones.
You're so incredible, Lulum. Then I'll support you every step of the way. Thank you, Mitsuki. I can do without you. Not at all. I'm happy to be a maiden disciple of the great Lulum, future ruler of Russia.
I think I managed to dodge that bullet at least, but I am kind of hungry. Hey, Mitsuki.
What is it?
Why don't we do a little shopping?
Being with you is really fun, Lulum.
You think?
That's right. I haven't enjoyed myself as much in ages.
Then you must have led a quite adult life.
You're probably right about that.
Mitsuki giggles softly. Mitsuki's arm is looped around my arm and she sticks close to my side. Her chest presses against mine, but I don't comment on it. Why should I? To be honest, it feels pretty nice. Mitsuki decided to forego the maid outfit when we went outside. I'm glad about it, too. I like being the center of attention and all, but since I'm a Cupid, I should be doing my best to lie low. After eating breakfast at a small restaurant and buying some more ingredients to cook at home, we decided to go to a small park. It's a nice park not so far away from my house. There's a lot of trees and grass and birds and flowers and all that other sort of stuff. It makes a nice change from the gray concrete and endless traffic that makes up Tokyo. It's in the middle of the day, so the park's pretty secluded. Most people are probably at work. I see a few humans who look around Mitsuki's age. College students on holiday, perhaps. But they don't stop to look at us.
This place is so scenic.
Mitsuki inhales deeply. The air smells of wildflowers and damp grass, wet with dew. I've been to this park a few times before. It's a prime location for couples to confess their love. I've helped more than one confession go along smoothly with my love bullets near their spawn. Never imagined I'd come here with somebody else, though. A human girl, no less. Pretty human girl who clings to me tightly like her life depends on it.
It's weird.
What's weird?
I haven't felt this happy in such a long time.
You keep saying that, girl. Calm down.
Weren't you happy in college? I was too busy to feel really much of anything. I had to attend lectures for hours every day, and then I had to work 2 part-time jobs to get enough money simply to eat. It always felt like there wasn't enough time, no matter how hard I worked. I couldn't really make any friends or attend any clubs because I was so busy. It was pretty lonely. You were probably the only person I talked to on a regular basis, Lilith. Maybe that's why I started falling for you.
Mitsuki snuggles against me even more closely, resting her head against my shoulder. I can feel her hair against my cheek. It's warmed by the summer sunlight and feels soft and silky. Her lips purse together like she's expecting a kiss. Mitsuki really is pretty. I always thought she was pretty, but she looks prettier than ever before now, beneath the warm sunshine. I never really paid much attention to her, but she's been trying hard in her own way, hasn't she? I can't imagine pushing myself like she does. I'm not cut out for it. That's why I was thrown out of heaven.
I never thought I'd be able to have a peaceful, relaxing time with you, just the two of us. It's so wonderful. It's like a dream. Well, if it's a dream, I hope I never wake up.
It's a game.
I love being with you. You make me feel so safe and warm.
And I like being with you too, Mitsuki.
Do you really mean it?
Yes, I've always wanted a cute young girl by my side to do my bidding. To look after me. I'm not so good at looking after myself.
Then I'll do it. I'll do anything for you.
You're such an earnest girl, Mitsuki. You better be careful. You might get taken advantage of one day.
By who?
By myself.
Well, I don't know.
I lean in a little closer to Mitsuki. I lift her chin up with my fingertip, forcing her eyes to meet. Mine are dark pink, the unearthly eyes of a Cupid.
Maybe a bad angel who was banished from heaven.
Not that I'm an angel, but that sounds cooler than Cupid.
I'm sure she would want to do all kinds of terrible things to you. I don't mind. You can do whatever you want with me, Lil. I don't care. I want to stay with you forever. I don't want things to ever change.
Oh, Mitsuki. I tilt my head down. Mitsuki tilts her head up. We're close. So, so close. I can feel Mitsuki's breath against my cheek. Any second now, our lips will brush. Any second now.
So, I finally found you!
Yeah!
Mitsuki draws away from me in a hurry and squeals an alarm. Oh, so much for that, then. And we were just getting to the good part.
Hey, who the hell are you, and why are you spying on me and my...
Oh. My voice breaks off. I know that girl standing before me with the braided hair and the serious expression. Her name is... I know her only too well. It's Sarah.
Hey, Lilith, isn't that the girl from the photograph in your house?
Indeed it is.
You still have that old photograph of me and even now?
Well, why not? We made a lot of precious moments together.
Precious? I'm precious?
She sounds too much like this girl.
I'm precious?
Yes, you're super adorable. You're super adorable when you blush like that.
Well, I am...
It's been months since I last saw you, but you still get flustered as easily as I remember.
I'm not flustered. She's really flustered.
I know, right?
I'm not.
Methinks the lady doth protest too much.
Son, this girl is your friend from school?
That's right. She's my darling Sarah. I didn't expect her to see her here, though. This is quite the unexpected visit.
Why is she here? Was she looking for you?
Well, I wonder... Did you miss me, Sarah? Is that it?
What? No, no way.
Did your little heart feel like it was going to break without my company? Did you cry into your pillow every night, wondering where your precious little one had gone? Did you come all the way here to claim me as your own with a kiss on the lips?
Don't be ridiculous. Wow, she's really going red.
I know, right? Isn't it great? Sarah looks super straight and laced, but it's just a front. An ex-lady, she's pretty shy and easily embarrassed. One only needs to know all the right buttons to press, and she'll fall apart in your hands.
Ahem.
Sarah clears her throat again and gives me a stern look.
I'm not here for idle chit-chat, Lilith.
Oh, no. And I did so miss our little talks.
Silence. I'm here under Gabriel's orders.
Gabriel? That's no fun. What does that boring little Bint want this time?
Bint?
That's no way to speak about one of the 7 archangels of heaven. Gabriel rules over our precinct. You should show her a little bit more respect.
Archangels? Lilith, what is she talking about?
Oh, yeah. I never really explained any of this stuff to Mitsuki, did I? Mitsuki might be aware, though vaguely, that I'm not exactly an ordinary human, but she doesn't know anything about heaven or cupids or angels or... Poor girl looks totally lost. Shh, don't worry your pretty little head over it. But... Shh. I press a finger against Mitsuki's lips. I'll tell you later. So you didn't reveal your true identity to this girl? Well, of course not. I might be a failure of a cupid, but I know better than that. But you did shoot her with a love bullet for your own gain. I only wanted a free cup of coffee. You got a little out of hand. But I guess I'm not opposed to having a cute girl at home to do my chores. Jeez, you haven't changed at all. Gabriel was right about you. You really have gone too far this time. Oh? This is getting interesting. Tell me, Sarah, what's this all about? Why did Gabriel send you here? Because you violated one too many of our laws. You shot a human girl with a love bullet for your selfish benefit, and then brought her back home to live with you. If she hasn't figured out your true identity yet, she will soon. It's only a matter of time. You're both talking in front of her. Is she gonna figure this out? Well, if you keep plotting about it. As such, I was ordered by Lady Gabriel to bring you back to Earth. Huh? But I thought I was banished from heaven. You were. Then why does Gabriel want me back? Can't she make up her mind? Gabriel thought if you were sent to Earth, you'd learn to repent for your sloth and avarice and become a hard-working cupid. If you'd done your job seriously, you would have been welcomed back to heaven with open arms. But it's too late now. You didn't try to improve yourself at all. In fact, you only slid into depravity. That's a cruel way to look at it. I'm just trying to have fun. Cupids aren't supposed to have fun. You need to work, and you need to work hard. But that's boring. We can't always drift through life doing things we like, Lilim. That's not how the world works. I glance at Mitsuki. She's sitting on the bench curiously, looking between us like a spectator at a tennis tournament. I wonder what she thinks about this. Your determination is admirable, Sarah. If you never let yourself take a break, you'll become miserable. Isn't that right, Mitsuki?
You're talking to me?
Of course. You're important to me, and I value your input.
Oh, Lilim, you're such a charmer.
I know, right? I wink at her. Sarah rolls her eyes. Please. Now, what were you and I just discussing? Didn't we say it's hard living life to living life to fulfill expectations and obligations? I don't really know what's going on, but you're right. I spent the last year busy with college and work. It didn't feel fulfilling. It was exhausting. If I'd kept going like that, I would have broken down. There, you see? Your way of life is admirable, Sarah, but it's not healthy. You have no right to lecture me about what's healthy and what isn't. You're so lazy you almost flunked out of Cupid Academy. But I had a lot more fun than anyone else. I don't want to hear about fun. You're coming back to heaven with me right now on Gabriel's orders. We need to stop you from making mischief. If you come with me, your punishment will be lenient. Should you refuse, however, you might get sent to hell.
Oh, scary.
And what will happen to Mitsuki if I leave? I'll wipe her memories, of course. It'll be like the last few days never happened.
Wipe my memories? But then I won't remember falling in love with Lilim or spending time with her.
You were never in love with Lilim. She shot you with a love bullet. It's melded with your mind.
Melded. It has melded with your mind. Ooh.
Lilim poisoned you.
Poison? No, it isn't true. I really do love her.
You just think you love her because of the love bullet. See, Lilim, you've caused this poor girl enough pain already. It'd be best for anyone and everyone if you left gracefully. If you care about this human girl, you won't hurt her anymore. If you care about me, you'd stop hurting me. I look between the two of them, Mitsuki and Sarah. Sarah wants me to return to heaven so I can shoot out by Gabriel. It's not a pleasing prospect, but... What do you want, Mitsuki? Do you want me to leave?
No!
Mitsuki's reply is almost instantaneous. She takes hold of my arm and squeezes it tightly.
I don't know anything about cupids or love bullets, but I do know that I love you. I've loved you for a long, long time. Even if you did shoot me with a love bullet, that just encouraged me to finally be honest with myself. It didn't change my feelings. I've always felt like this.
Mitsuki?
I don't want you to go. I was having such a good time with you. I've never been this happy before, not for a long time, and I can't lose you now.
You seem to have made quite an impression on this human girl. Jealous? Hardly. She can't be held accountable for what she's saying. Sarah presses a hot hand against her forehead. She looks tired. Really does sound like this girl cares for you, but she doesn't know what she feels right now. He's just confused.
I'm not confused. I know how my heart works better than anybody.
Forgive me for having doubts. So, Lilum, what will it be? Will you come back to heaven of your own volition, or... Sarah's eyes flash.
Whoa! Back to Purple Heart!
With blue hair. In an instant, her civilian clothes melt away to reveal her skin-tied cupid uniform. Her wings sprout from her shoulder blades. We'll have to take you back by force. I grit my teeth together. When you put it like that, I have only a real option, don't I?
Oh!
I won't go down with that fight. So that's your choice? Then come at me, Lilum.
Come at me, bro!
We might have been friends in the past, but I can't afford to show you any mercy now.
I won't lose.
I transform into my cupid form, then turn to look back at Mutsuki. She stares back at me.
This is what you did at the cafe, isn't it? And this morning.
That's right.
Oh, you thought maybe I was just seeing things. But you're really not a normal human, are you?
There's nothing normal about me, Mutsuki.
I see. This is a lot to take in.
I know. Don't think about it too much. I press a hand against Mitsuki's chest. Her body is enveloped in a warm, protective wall of light.
That probably used up quite a lot of love tokens.
I'm pretty low on love tokens since I don't go matchmaking nearly as much as Sarah does. But I can hardly leave Mitsuki on her own. What if she gets hurt?
Whatever.
That'll be fine. Just sit tight, Mitsuki. I'll defeat Sarah and then I'll take you home.
Do you promise?
I promise. Cross my hope I don't to die. I turn away from Mitsuki and look back at Sarah. She's regarding me coolly, her eyes narrowed.
So, you used your powers to protect that human girl?
Of course, I'm the one who shot her, so she's my responsibility.
Responsibility, huh?
Never thought I'd hear you of all people talking about that. Maybe I grew up a little dermax after all. I'll just have to test that.
Come on, Venus.
Wah!
Sarah holds her right arm above her head. In a flash of light, her trusty bow appears in her hands. Her weapon looks impressive, but... Really, though, Venus? That's such an unimaginable name.
Well, what do you suggest I call my weapon?
Maybe something a little more threatening? But cupids aren't supposed to threaten people. We're meant to bring them love and happiness. What do you call your love guns, anyway?
Huh? Oh. This is Love Pounder. It's pleased to meet you.
I wave my hand and my small automatic pistol appears in my hands. I grip it hard, searing the cool material against my skin. Sarah looks at me quizzically.
Love Pounder?
Yeah, isn't it cool?
It sounds kind of dirty. It only sounds dirty to those with dirty minds.
I don't. You're projecting.
I think you're the one who's projecting, my darling Sarah.
Don't call me that.
Why not? I think it's a cute name.
Shut up, idiot.
Is idiot the best you've got?
Shut up, shut up, shut up!
Sarah's face is heating up.
It's bright red. Oh, she looks so cute when she poses like that.
She really hasn't changed at all.
I'm going to end this right now. Prepare yourself.
Sarah fires an arrow from her bow, moves at supersonic speed, cleaving a path throughout the air. I'm able to dodge just in time. The air pushed aside by the arrow's trajectory catches my face. My hair flutters wildly in the breeze. The arrow hits a tree nearby and dissolves in a burst of pale blue articles.
Let's sure pack some punch.
Are you trying to kill me or something?
Not kill? Cupids aren't supposed to kill.
Then what's the big idea?
You just thought I might grievously injure you. Or something.
I thought we were supposed to be friends.
So did I, until you got so banished from heaven for being a no good layabout.
So you were lonely when I left?
I wasn't lonely at all.
Shut up.
Is that why you're trying so very hard to bring me back, even if it hurts me?
No, I'm doing this for Lady Gabriel. Next time I won't miss.
Well, there's a losing flag if I've ever heard one. Sarah shoots another arrow from her bow, but her aim is off. Maybe she's shaken from her conversation.
Poor little Sarah. You felt the determination, but you're so easy to manipulate.
Kind of like Joe, minus the determination part.
You'll need to try harder than that, Sarah.
Than this.
She loads a special arrow to the bow and shoots it. The arrow splits once, twice, three times, four times in the air, until a whole bevy of light, white light is raining down upon me. Each and every arrow looks like it'll hurt. You're really serious about this, huh?
Of course.
I'm going to bring you back even if you're unconscious, Lilum.
How scary. Too bad for you, I can do this. I conjure up another magic shield. It absorbs most of the bows from Sarah's magical arrows, but there's a lot of them to deflect. I'm trying to act tough, but I don't have all that many love tokens left. I can't keep making shields like this, or I'll be at a serious disadvantage. If I run out of love tokens, I won't be able to maintain my cupid form, and then I won't be able to use my weapons. I'll have to wrap this battle up as quickly as possible. Alright, Sarah, I'm coming for you. That's too naive. I push against the ground with the heel of my right foot and soar up into the air. The wind rushes through my hair and whistles in my ears. Sarah follows my movements with pinpoint precision. She loads another one of her special arrows and shoots it into the sky. The arrow splits apart. Dozens of rainbows rain down on me from above, but that will be Sarah's downfall. After firing off one arrow, she's unprotected. She doesn't have another one loaded in her bow. If I can reach Sarah faster than her arrows can reach me. If I can outfly the speed of a soaring arrow, there might be some hope yet. It sounds impossible that I can do it. I'll break through impossible odds. I won't let a trick like that stop me, Sarah. Just try and outpace my heroes, then. You are one of the best flyers at school, but not even you can bend the laws of physics. We'll just have to see about that, won't we? I dash on the side of a tree. The arrows fall after me, chasing me. I kick off against the side of the trunk hard. It propels me forwards towards the air. I'm faster now, much faster before. I can do it. I can reach Sarah. I'll get her before the arrows pierce my wings. Hey, what? Sarah's realized my plan, but it's too late now. I'm moving too quickly. I have too much momentum. Oh, hello. How's it going? I grab hold of Sarah, my fingers digging around her side, and press the barrel of my gun against her cheek. The arrows rain down around us, gouging chunks of earth and dirt out of the grassy ground. If they hit Sarah, they'll hurt her too. She has no choice but to summon a shield around us, protecting both of us from her attack. Sarah inhales deeply. Her chest rises and falls. Her whole body trembles. Sarah's pressed up against close to me. I can hear the sound of her heart beating. I can't believe it. I can't believe it either. Your speed's so reckless. You don't usually break out fancy attacks like that. You're too by the books. Well, Gabriel told me to do anything I could to win. I tried my best, but I guess I'm not used to handling magical arrows with such high amounts of energy. I didn't know how to utilize them. Don't be too hard on yourself, Sarah. Well, you did a good job. Really, I'm starting to get a little worried. But you're too slow. You don't react quickly enough. You already thought you'd won with a second magical arrow, so you didn't load your bow. You couldn't shoot me down when I was flying towards you. That was your downfall. I guess. Here's... pretty quick thinker. I wish you'd use some of that ingenuity in school. Words, but school was boring. You could be a great cupid if you tried hard, you know? You'd be much, much better than me. I don't know why you're throwing your future away. I don't care about the future. I want to have fun in the present. Fun, huh? Sometimes I wish I could be more like that. Well, you might have won this battle, but you won't win the war. I'll hunt you down to the very ends of the earth if I have to. And I'll drag you back to heaven by your hair, kicking and screaming and... Nope, I'm not interested in all that. Sorry. And then I pull the trigger. The love bullet passes straight through Sarah's head. Oh my god, no. Pheromones invade her bloodstream like a foreign toxin. She blinks. Her face flushes. She turns to look at me. Lilum? That's right, I'm Lilum. Oh my. I can't believe we're standing this close together. I can't believe I'm so close to the person I love more than anybody else in the world. I get that a lot. Lil, you smell so good. I've heard that before, too. You're so beautiful and charming and wonderful. I just... please, let's have babies together. I'm begging you. Babies? Now that's going a bit too far. Just how strong are my lobos anyway? The bullets are effective against cupids, but not to the same extent that they are humans. The magic imbued with them tends to wear out pretty quickly. But maybe it's different with my love bullets. I wonder how long Sarah will be stuck in this lovey-dovey state. Well, it doesn't really matter. She'll have more than enough time to make a speedy retreat. Lilith, please tell me. I love you so much, but you don't look at me with the... You don't look at me with long and adoring eyes. Is there anything I can do to make you love me like I love you? Is there anything... Anyway, I can earn your affection. If not, then there's no meaning to this hollow, empty life of mine. I might as well die. You don't need to go that far, Sarah. What is it with my love bullets and suicidal desires anyway? Maybe I should look into that. If you really want me to love you, the best thing you could do would be leaving me and Mitsuki in peace. Go back to heaven. That's all I ask. Go back to heaven, but then I won't be able to see your face again.
It's a price you'll have to pay if you want my undying love, I guess. I see.
I feel a little guilty about taking advantage of Sarah, but it's the only way I can get her off my back. I know I'm being underhanded, but all's fair in love and war. Maybe it's doubly fair if you combine the two? Well, it's a harsh penalty to pay, but I understand. Absence does make the heart grow fonder, after all. Perhaps if I go to heaven, you remain on earth, your true feelings towards me shall awaken. That's right, Sarah. Doesn't hurt to try. Indeed. Then I shall do as you've instructed, Lilith. They say if you love somebody, you should be willing to let them go. And that's precisely what I'll do now. Adieu, Lilith. I must depart, but I will think of you the whole time we are parted. And with that, Sarah vanishes in a flash of light. I sigh deeply and dissolve my gun into non-existence. My Cupid's form goes next, until I look like an ordinary human once more. An ordinary human with bright pink hair and pink eyes. Oh well, they're less of ostentation than the wings. Jeez, what a pain. I sigh and stretch my arms above my head. I haven't been in a serious fight for a while. One wrong move and Sarah could have speared me. I managed to make it out unscathed this time, but what about the next? I sent Sarah away for now, but it's only a temporary measure. Knowing her, she'll come back. If Lady Gabriel gave her an official order to bring me back to heaven, she can't not come back. Sarah values her status as a Cupid far too much. What, does she value it even more than our friendship? I better be on my guard from now on. Ever since I shot Mitsuki, my life has been incredibly complicated. And all I ever wanted to do on Earth was relax and eat snacks. Why must fate conspire against me like this? Why is everything so difficult? I don't know, girlfriend. Are you alright, Mitsuki?
I'm fine. I'm a little shaken about everything that just happened at the park, though.
I think anybody would be shaken by that.
I just wanted to go on a next relaxing day with you.
Huh? So that's the part that's shaking you?
Well, I thought I'd be able to spend some quality alone time with you, but then this other girl appeared out of nowhere. It just isn't fair.
And you don't care that we're Cupids and we can sprout wings and we're from heaven?
Well, I did think that was kind of weird.
Just kind of?
But I always sensed there was something strange about you. You don't act like an ordinary human. I think that's what drew me to you to begin with.
So you don't mind that I shot you with a love bullet?
I don't mind. You shot me with a love bullet the moment I set my eyes on you.
Well, that's reassuring, but... Sarah might have a point. My love bullets are custom made. They're a lot stronger than the arrows Cupids typically use. I thought of giving you a deluded shot, but I might have made a mistake. You think you love me, but your feelings might not be true. It could be an illusion. When the after effects fade away, you'll come to your senses. You'll be the same old Mitsuki you were before. And your feelings for me will probably change. Your feelings for me might be a lie. One of them. Mitsuki leans forward on the couch. She extends her hands, linking her fingers together. Her palm is soft and warm. It's comforting.
My feelings for you aren't a lie.
But how do you know that?
I'll admit, I did feel kind of funny at the cafe yesterday. I don't remember it too well, but I guess that would be when you shot me. All of a sudden, I was hit with a desire to be honest for once in my life. I wanted to confess my real feelings to you without hiding behind a mask. Maybe you did coerce me into confessing, but you didn't change my feelings. I loved you from the very beginning. You just helped me be more open about it. I know myself better than anybody. I know my feelings aren't a lie. They're not. I really have had more fun with you than I've had in the last few years of my life. If anyone says that's not true, I'll tell them that they're wrong. Even if that person's you.
Mitsuki. I stare at her in awe. Unbidden, I find myself squeezing your fingers with my own. She really is strong. She's far, far stronger than I ever imagined.
I want to stay with you, Lilith. That's the truth.
Really?
Really.
Always?
Yes, always. I'll stay by your side no matter what.
Well, that's very reassuring to hear, but Sarah won't give up. She wants me to go back to heaven. She was ordered to bring me back by Gabriel herself.
Then we'll have to drive Sarah off, no matter how many times it takes. She was your friend at school, wasn't she? She should understand.
It'd be nice if that were true, but Sarah's remarkably stubborn. And even if we manage to fend her off for good, Gabriel will come and get me herself. She can be quite scary when she gets serious.
Then we'll fight her, too.
But Gabriel's one of the archangels who governs heaven. She's far stronger than me.
I don't care. Whatever you is stronger than anything.
Mitsuki.
It isn't like you to give up, Lilith. You're not acting like the cool woman I know. I hate you. Believe in yourself. Believe in my love for you. If you're together, we can do anything.
Mitsuki. I'll find myself smiling before I can stop myself. Just being with this silly human girl make my heart feel so light. Thank you, Mitsuki. I don't really want to go back to heaven, so I'll do my best and I won't give up. I'm going to stay on Earth no matter what. It doesn't matter if Gabriel or even Raphael or Ariel or any of the other archangels try to pull me away. I'll fight them all. I have to. I think finally I've found a place in this big, wild, wide world where I can be myself. Where I can be happy. And where I belong.
Meanwhile, in the celestial office of Archangel Gabriel, one of the seven overseers of heaven, purple-hearted Gabriel have a long talk.
So you let her escape?
That's right. I'm very sorry, Lady Gabriel. This happened solely because of my own carelessness.
Well, I'm glad you'll be willing to take responsibility for your mistakes. But I am disappointed, Seraphim. You graduated from Cupid Academy at the highest grades in your cohort. Lilum was only barely able to scrape by. You should have been able to apprehend her with ease.
I know, it's all my fault. It's because I made a mistake. I didn't realize how cunning she is.
How cunning can she be? The grades across the board were lower than average. She doesn't seem to be particularly intelligent.
It's because Lilum's lazy. She's smart. I've always known that, but she never bothered applying herself. Not until she went to Earth and met that human girl.
Ah, yes, the human girl. Tell me, how much does she know?
Well, about that. Seems the girl didn't know all that much.
So Lilum didn't tell her about her true identity?
No, she didn't. I don't think the girl knew anything about Heaven or Cupid's until I descended to Earth to apprehend Lilum.
So you engaged in combat with Lilum in front of a human?
Yes.
I must say, Sarah, that doesn't sound like you. I did tell you to bring Lilum back by any means possible, but I thought you'd be a bit more careful.
I'm sorry, I was foolish of me. I just underestimated how close Lilum would be with that human girl. They were nigh inseparable. And Lilum even used her magic to protect that girl during her fight. It was like she really cared about her. Maybe that's why she was fighting so hard. I didn't expect her to take it so seriously. Lilum's never taken anything seriously before, so why... Why that girl?
That is something you'll have to uncover for yourself. If it is true this human girl was largely ignorant about heaven until you intervened, then you committed a grave offense. You'll never be promoted to an angel if you continue to act so carelessly.
Oh, Lady Gabriel, I'm sorry.
Apologies mean little. Words are empty. What I want is action.
Yes, of course.
It's now of the utmost concern that you bring Lilum back. Bring her to me and erase the memories of that human girl, too. If you don't, it won't be a promotion that's on the line. You might get banished, too.
Banished? Oh, of course. I can't trust careless Cupid to leak our secrets to the masses. It would be a fitting punishment, don't you think? But I graduated from Cupid Academy at the top of my class. I've always applied myself seriously and diligently, and I was just following your orders. I tried my best, but Lilum got the better of me.
Then you'd better work doubly hard in the future. Believe me, it pains me to say this, too. You are one of heaven's shining beacons. You are a wonderful woman, but... Do not let me down again. Otherwise, there'll be hell to pay.
Yes, of course. I'll make the preparations to apprehend Lilum right away.
Good. See to it that you do. Ugh. I'm surrounded by incompetent fools. How hard can it be to return one rogue Cupid back to heaven? I thought you were supposed to be smart, Seraphim. Now I'm having doubts. If she can't bring Lilum back next time, then I might have to step in. Maybe the old saying is true. If you want something done right, you have to do it yourself.
Outside the offices of heaven!
I still can't believe that happened. How did I let Lilum get the better of me? She might be a more creative fighter than I am. Her weapons are more powerful, but I have more experience in combat. The old woman I know wouldn't have protested so fiercely. She has always been so lazy. Maybe I underestimated her. There must be a reason why she was so determined during that fight. That human girl. Mitsuki, was it? I wonder what their relationship is really like. Lilum fought me to protect Mitsuki. She gave it everything she had. Her eyes were blazing. She was so passionate. Never seen her look that serious before. Was it all because of that human girl? It's not fair. Lilum's only known her for a few months. What's so special about that girl anyway?
Oh, she's jealous.
She didn't look so special to me. Now I've known Lilum longer.
Lilum used to be my friend. I can't stand it. I'll be bring Lilum back to heaven no matter what.
She belongs to me.
Ooh, I won't let that human girl have her. This time I won't lose.
My bed is so warm and toasty. I never want to wake up. Just 5 more minutes. Lilim, I said, just 5 more minutes. Lilim, come on, Mitsuki, I already said I only want 5 more
Oh, I stopped. The person in my room holding a bow and arrow isn't Mitsuki. It's Sarah. So, I transform into my Cupid form. My lingerie melts from my body to be replaced by my skin-tight suit.
What are you doing here so early in the morning? I came to retrieve you as soon as I can. Under late gay Gabriel's orders.
How sweet! You're that desperate to see me, huh?
Shut up! How did you even get inside my room? I glance out the window. It's open. I must have forgotten to lock it last night. Did you seriously fly into my room while I was asleep?
What of it? It's kind of creepy.
I hope you weren't staring at me while I was asleep.
Hey, as if I do something like that! I wasn't thinking about how unusually pretty you were when you keep your mouth shut for more than 5 minutes of anything.
Sure. Sarah really isn't very good at lying, is she? She's so adept at all your to falsehood, it's kind of adorable. Sarah inhales deeply and squares her shoulders. She looks at me staunchly. I might have failed yesterday, but I won't fail now. I've strengthened both my heart and my resolve. You're coming back with me whenever you want to or not.
So you wanted to ambush me?
That's right. You know, this tactic would have been a lot more effective if you hadn't woken me up first. Why didn't you castigate me while I was asleep?
That wouldn't be fair. Lady Gabriel might have ordered me to bring you back using any method possible, but I at least won't want to give you a chance to defend yourself. Besides, you used to be my best friend.
How sweet. You really are a darling, Sarah. But that's why you'll never be able to bust me.
I rise from her bed at the exact moment Sarah fires her magical arrow. I throw the duvet up high in the air over Sarah's head.
What?
The arrow's pierced through the thin sheets easily, but it's enough to throw Sarah off balance. She misfires, and instead of hitting me, the arrows ricochet about my room. The alarm clock on my bed table that I never used is scored against the wall. My mirror cracks in about 5 different places. A vase of flowers on my desk is splintered. Bits of ceramic and stagnant water and half-dead daffodils litter my floor.
I'm a little annoyed about that, but there's no time to worry about the damages.
I have to make my move now. Well, Sarah's still incapacitated. I dash forwards, kicking off against my bed.
Lilim!
Sarah's managed to throw the torn divot off of her body finally, but it's too little too late. I already have her. My room's small. Sarah uses a ranger weapon, so she's at a significant advantage. I use guns. If I can get in close, she has no way to counter me. And that duvet was all the distraction I need. I wrap my right arm around her, keeping her pinned in place. And summon Blood Pounder with a slight kick, flick of my wrist. My pistol materializes in a burst of pale pink light. I press the cold, hard barrel of the gun against Cyril's temple, just like before. We're pressed up so close together, I can feel her body trembling against mine. I can hear her heart pounding in her chest. There's nowhere for her to run. Nowhere to hide.
Looks like I won yet again. I wouldn't count on that.
Huh?
Take this! Feel my divine wrath!
Sarah stamps on her right foot with the heel of her boot.
Ah! That really smarts. What's so divine about that? I'm a Cupid. Everything I do is divine.
Even going to the restroom?
Enough!
Sarah grinds her heel down on my foot.
I hope she hasn't broken anything.
Alarmed and in pain, my grip on Sarah loosens. She throws me over her shoulder. My body goes flying through the air and I land on my duvet with a thud. I bounce once, twice, and then stop. My heart is pounding. And my head too.
Meanie, it was payback for shooting me with that love bullet last time. It's not my fault you left yourself wide open.
And now you're the one who's open. Sarah points her bow and arrow at me once more. She presses the tip of the arrow against my chest. I blink up at her, pinned to my bed on my back, just like a bug. I have now. She's right. I don't have the duvet anymore. It's crippled up on the floor. I can't use it to protect myself, and neither can I use it to confuse Sarah. There's nothing for me to do. Nowhere for me to run.
You put up a good fight, but it's clear who the victor is. Now lie back and accept defeat.
You mean you're going to shoot me with that thing?
Of course.
If you shoot me at such close range, you could do some real damage. That didn't stop you from shooting me in the head.
That's the fair point, I guess. Compared to the humiliation you put me through, I think I'm being rather kind. I'll shoot you. I'll make you fall in love with me, even if it's only for a few minutes. And then I'll bring you back to heaven. So that's a point, is it? Simple, but it'll be hard for me to wiggle out of this skitty thing. She just needs to draw back the arrow, and shoot, and it's all over. I'll go back to heaven, and Mitsuki? So erase Mitsuki's memory. I can't let that happen. I won't let that happen. What can I do? I try to appeal on Mitsuki's behalf. Wait, Sarah, you can't do this! Why not? I was given orders by Lady Gabrielle. You should know that her orders are absolute. I'll be in trouble if I don't follow them. That might be true, but what about Mitsuki? The human girl you're living with? That's right. Sarah's eyes narrow. She grits her teeth together. Is it just me or does she look really pissed? I know she's a stickler for the rules and all, but this idea of me living with a human girl grinding her gears that badly? Or maybe she isn't mad because I'm living with a human girl. Could it be? Is she jealous? I don't see why I should spare a thought for a human girl I have no connection with. My business isn't with Mitsuki, it's with you. But Mitsuki's part of this too. She's involved. If you take me back to heaven with you, you'll wipe her memories, won't you? Of course, that's standard protocol. Why do you ask? I was just thinking. Wiping Mitsuki's memories seems like too harsh a punishment. This is supposed to be a punishment. I have to wipe her memories so heaven will remain a secret. If word got out that heaven really does exist, the human world would be thrown into panic. That would make it much, much harder for us keepers to do our jobs. Don't you remember? They taught us that on our very first day at Cupid Academy. I remember, but Mitsuki's different. I know she won't tell anyone about us, even if you leave her be. And how can you be so sure? Because I trust her. Trust her? How can you trust her? Sarah's eyes narrow even further until they look like slits. Her voice is cold and tightly controlled, but her pupils are blazing with fire. Her fingers tremble. She's shaken. All this talk about Mitsuki is having a noticeable effect on her composure. If I keep pushing it, maybe I'll distract her so much I can slip up from beneath her. I trust her because she's a good, pure soul. I know Mitsuki would never betray me. But you've only known her for 2 days. Actually, I've known her for 6 months. And you've known me for years and years. We went to preschool together. Aren't we best friends? We are best friends, but Mitsuki's special. If I have to go back to heaven with you, I will, but I'll sorely miss my dear Mitsuki. She did everything for me. She cooked and cleaned and oh. Am I laying it on a bit too thick? It's a good thing I'm a decent actress. I can crank out the waterworks in seconds. But erasing Mitsuki's memories of our life together, no matter how brief, that really is cruel. If I can't remain on this earth by my beloved's side, then I hope that some tender memory of me may remain in Mitsuki's heart to forever link us together. Beloved? What do you mean, beloved? You haven't. Sarah's brow furrows. It's not a very attractive look. You haven't fallen in love with her, have you? So what if I have? But we've been friends for so long. It's true, we were friends. We are still, in fact. Then why are you choosing Mitsuki girl over me? Oh, Sarah. Poor uneducated Sarah. Uneducated? For such a smart girl, you don't know very much at all about human relationships. Though I love you as a friend, the love I share with you is far, far different than the love I feel towards Mitsuki. They can't be compared. My love for you is soft and tender, like a cherry blossom fluttering in the breeze. But my love for Mitsuki is burning and all-consuming like a forest fire. This passion of mine has already claimed me. I cannot dream without seeing Mitsuki's face, and I cannot think without her name circulating through my mind. How could I let my beloved forget me? Here it is, the final blow! When we've already consummated our love! Consummated? You don't mean... Sarah takes a step backwards. Her grip on her bow slackens in shock. Here's my chance. I have to take it now. Thank you for lowering your bow, Sarah. I get to my feet, pushing myself upwards, tore off the bed. And thank you for being so easy to fall. With one movement, I summon my pistol from thin air and press it against Sarah's temple. You tricked me. That's right. Now hold still. I don't give Sarah a chance to try and fight back this time. My foot still smarts from earlier. And I don't have stabbing on the other one. I won't let her. Without mercy, I press my fingers against the trigger. And I fire yet another love bullet into Sarah's head. I can't believe it. I lost again. Sarah sits on the couch in the living room, staring at her feet. She sniffs.
The effects of the lead bullet have long since worn off, but she hasn't gone back to heaven yet. I wonder why. Maybe she's given up? For the past half hour, she's been sitting on my couch, quietly despairing. It's kind of creepy, actually.
Do you think she'll be all right?
I'm not sure. Sarah's always been pretty serious. If she scored anything other than a perfect in her exams, she took it to heart. Losing to me not once but twice must have been quite a blow to her self-esteem.
Which is, from what I recall, already pretty fragile. Ah, it's hopeless. I'm a useless failure of a Cupid. I can't believe I screwed up. I had a perfect chance and I ruined it. What would Lady Gabriel say? How could I face her now? I can't go back to heaven like this.
Hey, Sarah, are you alright?
She's crying, Lilum.
Yeah, I can see she's crying. Is there anything I can say that'll cheer Sarah up? Sarah?
What?
You might have lost the fight, but you really gave it your all. I can tell how hard you tried. You shouldn't get in trouble if you go back to heaven. Gabriel should praise you for doing your best. You just got unlucky, being pitted against a sly, wily, sexy femme fatale like me. I strike a pose. Doesn't seem to cheer her up. She's still pouting. She looks kind of adorable when she pouts. Makes me want to stroke her cheeks between my fingers.
You're wrong, Willem.
Huh? You mean I'm not sexy?
No, not about that.
Not that I ever look at you in that way, of course.
Of course. You better not.
I can't go back to heaven now. Lady Gabriel told me. She said if I messed up another mission to bring you back, she'd banish me.
She'd banish you?
That sounds a little harsh.
I know, that's what I thought, but Lady Gabriel was quite draconian. She doesn't take failures lightly.
A failure, huh? I guess that's what I am now.
Her eyes don't look even deader than a fish's.
I can see that. I wave a hand in front of Sarah's face. She doesn't react. She just sits there, staring blankly into space.
This could be bad.
Being banished from heaven would be an incredible blow against a serious girl like Sarah, who's always worked hard her whole life. She's such a good, pure girl. She doesn't deserve to be punished so harshly. Maybe if I return to heaven of my own volition, Gabriel would forgive Sarah. But I don't want to do that. If I went back, then Mitsuki... I guess for the time being, this is all I can do.
You know, I've been thinking.
What? At least she's engaging with me. That's something. For a while, I was starting to worry her soul vacated her body through sheer shame. Maybe you lost those two fights with me because you wanted to lose.
What? What do you mean?
Well, look at it logically.
Like you ever thought about logic.
Hey, even I can engage in incredible thinking from time to time. Thank you very much. Not that I'm going to start reading about rationality or anything. See, Sarah, here's the thing. We've been friends for a long time, right? Ever since we were little kids? Remember how we used to race around the clouds back in grade school and catch the doves in the air even when we got in trouble? Catching the doves wasn't my idea, it was yours. But you still went along with it, even though we got scolded by Uriel.
Well, even though it was against the rules, it was kind of fun, I guess.
You see? We've had lots of fun times together, and that's why you don't want to beat me. No, I don't fit in. You know I don't fit in back in heaven. Yeah, it makes sense. Okay. You know I don't fit in back in heaven. You know being there made me feel miserable. And that's why, even though Gabriel herself asked you to bring me back, you wouldn't do it. You couldn't bring yourself to. You were thinking about me this whole time, weren't you?
No, I wasn't.
Sure. This girl is such a bad liar, it's almost painful. But I have to thank you, Sarah.
For being useless?
For being conscientious. It's because you care about me and our friendship that you didn't drag me back to heaven, and I appreciate it a lot. I owe you one.
Whatever.
It's not like I want you to be my debt. I mean, what good is going to do me now? I'm not even allowed back to my own home. Might not be allowed back in your own home in heaven, but you're more than welcome to stay here. Are you sure?
Do you really think that's a good idea, Lilith? This girl tried to kidnap you by force, not just once but twice. But she wants you to erase my memories. For all we know, this could be a clever ploy. What if she's plotting against us?
Sarah isn't the best to plot. She's not underhanded enough. Sarah's the kind of girl who announces her arrival even when she's trying to pull off a surprise attack. She can't stand the idea of being unfair. To put it bluntly, she has a lot of book smarts but no common sense.
Hey, that's mean.
But you didn't say it was untrue.
Well, maybe. I guess I still have a lot to learn.
You think you're fine the way you are now.
Willem, do you really mean that?
That's right.
It's because you're so pure and honest and incorruptible that you're super fun to bully. You haven't changed since we were kids, Lilim. And you haven't changed at all either. That's why I'm asking you to stay here. It's because I trust you after all these years. And we're still best friends, right? Well, I guess you're right. I don't have anywhere else to go now, and you are my best friend. Great, then it's decided. But beam brightly and clap my hands together. You don't mind, do you, Mitsuki? Well, this is your house. If you really want to let this girl stay here, I suppose I can't argue. You can do what you want, but what? You better be careful, Sarah. Mitsuki grabs a saucepan. Where did she put that on from exactly? And points it in Sarah's direction. If you dare do anything to hurt me or Limo, I'll make you pay in blood. Don't think that going a bit far, too far? Not at all. I'm doing this because of love you. I won't let anybody hurt you. The Sarah girl has a finger and you will break clean off. Okay, that's a little creepy. Maybe I should keep an eye on Mitsuki from now on. I don't want her to do anything illegal. Good. Speaking of potentially illegal things, here you go, Sarah. Eat up. What is this exactly? It's a delicious homemade omelet. Omelet, you say? I'm not familiar with the food you humans eat on Earth, but I don't know. I didn't know omelet was supposed to look like this. It's my own original recipe. Original, huh? It certainly looks unique. Thank you. I poured my heart and soul into making this just for you. Well, I thought you didn't trust me. I don't, but I do trust Lilim's judgment. Any friend of hers is a friend of mine, and I wanted to welcome you to our group. Now, you must be hungry. Please, we'll let her dig in. Are you sure this is all right? Of course I'm sure. I made it just for you. And I'm very thankful, but, well, what do you think, Lilim? Sarah looks at me for guidance. I swear I can see a comically oversized droplet of sweat rolling down her brow, and I can't say I blame her. Mitsuki's cooking hasn't improved over the last day. If anything, it's gotten worse. It'd be terrible to call up Mitsuki's meal an omelet at all. It's not even remotely recognizable as a food substance. Most of it is charred black, but bits of it are flecked with green, purple, and even yellow. A truly foul smile rises from Mitsuki's concoction. When I squint, I swear I can see a fish head poking out from beneath the folds of the unappetizing mush. I'm not sure Mitsuki managed to create something so hideous, but it's kind of impressive. Is she really trying to welcome Sarah back to her family, or is she trying to punish her for getting between us? I don't know. But I do know the sweet smile on Mitsuki's face is nothing short of terrifying. Maybe I should give Sarah some advice before she falls foul of a horrible fate. Warn Sarah. Good Samaritan. Yeah, I wouldn't eat that if I were you. But I put so much time and effort into creating this dish. I know, and I'm sure Sarah's very grateful, but I'm kind of having a craving for fast food right now. Oh, is that so? Yeah. Hey, I have an idea. Since Sarah's new to our household and she's not too familiar with human customs, why don't we go somewhere fun? Fun? That's right. It's still pretty early, so we should go out together and enjoy ourselves. We'll stop to get a bite to eat on the way. What do you say? Well, if you're sure. It seems a bit shame to waste to omelet, though. Maybe I'll wrap it up and put it in the fridge for another day. That's right, you do that, Mitsuki. But don't blame me if it happens to go missing in the middle of the night. Sarah looks at me, her eyes wide with gratitude. And she rises from the table with faulty steps. The smell of the omelet must have left an impact. She whispers, thank you. Under her breath, I guess that's one casualty you averted. I've done my good deed for the day. What manner of place is this? Sarah looks around her surroundings, her eyes and mouth both open. She looks like she's just seen a unicorn, and I guess I can understand her surprise. This place is a little overwhelming, even for me. I've never been here before either, but I've seen it enough times on TV. It's a theme park, but it's not just any theme park. It's THE theme park you go to if you're in Tokyo. It's the one and only...
Is it obvious? We're at Destiny Land!
Destiny Land? We're only in the entrance plaza, but I can hear the shrill screams of crowds being jerked about on roller coasters in the distance. Cheery music pipes through the air. People in animal costumes welcome us into the park. A young girl lets go of her balloon and starts sniffling as it flies away through the azure sky.
Destiny Land. A land of hopes and dreams. But Sarah looks completely out of her element. I've never heard of this place before.
What? Really?
Really.
Where have you been living? Under a rock?
In heaven, actually. Living under a rock sounds rather cramped and impractical.
I wasn't being serious, you know.
I take everything seriously. It's the only way one can become a good Cupid.
I can tell. I think it's one of Sarah's charm points.
You don't need to ruffle my hair. But I wanna. I suppose I'll allow it for now.
I knew she'd cave in. No girl can resist my charms. Honestly, though, I can't believe it. How can you have not heard of Disneyland in this day and age?
I don't have enough time to research things like this. I'm too busy with work. Besides, I've never been to the human Sarah catches the eye of a small child a few paces away, chomping on a bright pink candy floss, and pauses.
Tokyo before. I didn't know you had such huge plazas like this, filled with so many people. And so much noise, too.
Sarah pulls a face. Is this a spot of pagan worship? I open my mouth ready to counter a question when... I pause. Maybe Sarah isn't too far off the mark after all. I guess, in a sense, Disneyland is a little bit like a site of pagan worship. But the people who pilgrimage here don't come to worship gods. They come to worship the face that dominates all of Western civilization. Roland Rat. How did a cartoon rat gain so much power anyway? Even some of the girls back in Cupid Academy had Roland Rat-themed stationery tote bags. They thought he was cute. Sarah might be the only Cupid who doesn't know about Destinyland. It's because she's so super serious. She never had time for anything other than studying. She never had any dreams bigger than being a top-class Cupid. She had no places she wanted to go, no sights she wanted to see. To be honest, it's kind of sad. Maybe that's why I wanted to bring her here. As Sarah's friend, it's my job to help her expand her horizons. Putting the paganism to one side for now, I think you might enjoy this place, Sarah. It's popular with young women, and the characters here are cute, right?
I don't know.
Sarah eyes one of the staff members distrustfully. This place is full of foul sidles. It doesn't seem very virtuous. Sarah looks at the small child with the candy floss again. Her nose wrinkles. And they start indoctrinating them so young, too.
I don't know what you're talking about, but this isn't an evil place. In fact, it's the happiest place on Earth!
And how can that be quantified exactly?
It's all over the advertisements. Everyone knows that.
Well, I don't.
Then try listening. In Destinyland, the staff dress up as characters from Destiny movies, and there are lots of rides and delicious food. It's amazing. I've always wanted to come here ever since I was a little girl, but my parents didn't really have the money. Thank you for bringing me here, Willem.
Mitsuki takes hold of my hands with her own. Our fingers loop together. Her eyes are bright and shining like shooting stars, and her face is flustered and flushed. Mitsuki doesn't look happy. This doesn't begin to cover it. She looks elated.
This is like my childhood dreams come true! I always wanted to know what Disneyland was like, but it's even better than I imagined.
Hey, now, you don't need to thank me. I pat her on the head. I like spoiling my girls.
Your girl, I'm your girl. How dreamy. That's almost as dreamy as going to Destinyland.
I'm glad I made you happy. I've always wanted to come here for a while, too. I figured it'd be fun if we went around together, but are you not enjoying yourself, Sarah?
Well,
Sarah bites her lower lip. She looks around the plaza with its pastel buildings and fruit carts and frowns. It's a bit overwhelming. I've never been anywhere like this before, and there's so many people. An empty styrofoam cup still licking coffee bounces along the ground. It hits Sarah's shoe and comes to a sudden halt. There's a lot of litter, too. I don't know if this is my kind of place. It's a bit too much for me.
Might not like it, but it's exactly my kind of place. I'm super happy we came here.
Mitsuki loops her arm through mine and squeezes against my side.
If you didn't like it, Sarah, you can just go home. I want to explore the park with Willem. Isn't that for the best? Wouldn't it make everybody happy?
Well, I've never been to a place like this before, and I must admit, I am somewhat curious. I like exploring new places and learning about new things. It helps the mind to develop, and I don't want to be ignorant. If I'm going to leave here now, I can't afford to be ignorant. Knowledge is power. I'm interested, but I don't want to look around. I want to look around on my own. If you think I would be bothered, then I can always leave.
Maybe you should. I don't want anybody interrupting my lovey-dovey time with Willem.
I thought as much. You two really are close, huh?
That's right.
Then I'm just a third wheel.
Sarah.
I look between Sarah and Mitsuki. Mitsuki is still clinging to my arm while Sarah is standing a few feet away, the empty cup of coffee still at her right foot. She looks awkward, and she's staring down at the ground. I should have known. Sarah's never been very good with crowds, and despite being so book smart, she doesn't have any street smarts. If it weren't for me, she'd be totally overwhelmed. Sarah can't look around at the park on her own, but Mitsuki doesn't even want to share me. Will I have to make a choice between the two of them? Oh, for the love of God. Almighty. We'll leave it at that. If you want to see more, hit that subscribe button. Hit the bell notification, too. Like, comment if you feel like doing it. Hope you have a great day. Hope to see you again next time. Thanks, everyone. Bye.